morning, everybody. What's going on? This is Alex63501 here at the Base Channel, wishing you a happy Friday morning. Hope you're all doing well today. Thought I'd do something a little different, experiment a little bit with theme music. I just love this song. Anyway, if you're just joining us here today, then you have chosen the best day, in my opinion, to join in on our discussion of Takanaka here, because today is the day that we go through and we look at Rainbow Goblins. But not just the album Rainbow Goblins, we are going to watch the live version from 1982, the year after it came out, which Master of Owls was kind enough to give me a great link to. All of you guys had really good suggestions on where to find that. Awesome, thank you so much. And so we're going to look at that today. And if you have been with us all week, we are finally going to see that prog rock slash concept album that I've been talking about, kind of alluding to here for couple weeks now. So, I'm gonna go ahead, and as much as I love some second album Takanaka, we gotta get it on to his seventh album. So, I'm gonna go ahead and just turn that all the way down. Okay, boom. So, as I said, Rainbow Goblins. Very interesting album, very interesting story behind the album here. All right, morning Poppy, good to see you. All right, so talking about this album here a little bit, let's just go ahead and dive right on in. Boom, switching cameras to the left. Hello. So this album here, let's just look first of all to see where it's seated in our Takanaka discography. So this is where we were. Boom, Seashells, that was Tuesday. Insatiable High, Wednesday. And then Takanaka, great name. Third album, and this was all in 1976. And then the second two were in 77. So very early on in his career, 15 second recap. He had been part of a band previously, Sadistic Mikas, fell apart, took some people from that to do his first album. Second album was a whole lot of American musicians, jazz musicians and different studio musicians like that. Then Takanaka from the same year was back some people from his first album and then some new people again. And now what we're going to see here, which is 8 albums later, we have even more new people. I think we've got one person who is the same other than Takanaka who has stuck through the entire time, but I think that might be it. But we do have a bass player that we haven't seen in a while. Somebody put me out of my Japanese misery here. Akihiro Tanaka. And this is a person who we have seen playing with Taiko Nuki, plays with Henri at some point, Tatsuro Yamashita. Doesn't get to play on Right on Time, but he gets Moonglow right before. Just missed it, buddy. Anyway, so on top of this just being a cool concept album that deviates from our previous Takanaka style of music, this is also based on a very famous children's book written by an Italian author, whose name I'm really not going to try to pronounce. We're just going to call him Count Ulderico. Close enough. Morning, Al. Good to see you. And so he was a illustrator, child's book author. He ended up writing this book called The Rainbow Goblins, 1978. So this would have been 3 years before this album came out. And it was, you know, successful. People liked it. They thought it was cool. He was noted most... or the highest praise he received was for the illustrations. They were especially interesting. Let me see. I didn't even think when I was preparing this morning to try to look up some nice pictures of the Rainbow Goblins book because I was too concerned thinking about another musical connection that I want to talk to you guys about. So here we go. Here is a picture. Let's see if I can find a nice picture here. There we go. Of the kind of art style that we're looking at here as far as this... Ulderico, the guy who illustrated and wrote The Rainbow Goblins, the book. And then we've got over here, here's another example of these Rainbow Goblins, what they look like. And we're going to see what the story is like. But from what I understand, it's the later one he wrote called White Goblins. That one's actually the one that's real dark and depressing. So this one is still pretty positive and lighthearted. But what I think is interesting about this, on top of just it being a cool story and a cool idea that Takanaka made an album to this, but one of my other very, very favorite bands, Primus, who, if y'all are some bass player, Les Claypool, who's the frontman bass player for that, they did a concept album called The Desaturating Seven, which is also based off this, that came out, I think it was 3 years ago? Let's see when it says. 2017, yeah. Prog rock album, again based on this. And I had one of my friends actually got to go to this concert and see them perform it live, and he got a Rainbow Goblins poster and has it signed, and I'm so jealous. I'm so jealous, Al. You know what you have. Anyway, but it's very cool. If I had enough time, I would love, and maybe we'll do this in the future, to look through this album and listen to it and compare it from this version to Takanaka's version. Because again, Takanaka did it first, and he has this right as it came out, 3 years after the book came out, and then 30 years later, now we've got Desaturating 7 coming out. Also, I like how this label is ATO Records. Didn't know that. Okay, now going back into the Rainbow Goblins. Let's take a look here real quick at what we've got going on in the album as far as the tracks, the players, and then we're going to do the same thing we've been doing all week. I'm going to try to let it flow. I'm going to try to let the whole show just go on underneath. I think we're missing maybe one or two tracks. Let's look here and see what we've got as far as the track listing, comparing it here to what we have on Discogs. All right. Morning, Juanita, what is going on? Randomly generated. You see, couldn't even get it out of my mouth, and you you already knew what was going on. What's up, Ohajiman? Good to see you. Perfect timing, y'all. So we're getting ready to watch the 1982 live version of Rainbow Goblins. So we just did a little bit of background story talking about the artist, who it came from, a guy named Del Rico, Italian illustrator. We also talked about how Primus made an album many, many years later, more recently. And now we're making sure that we have all of our tracks here before we jump right in. So we got our prologue, Once Upon a Time, Seven Goblins. Oh, yeah. That's the song I'm looking for. Sunset Valley, Moonrise, Soon, Thunderstorm. Okay, it looks like we're missing a couple tracks here, so we might have to come back later and check these out. Thunderstorm, Rising Arch, Just a Chuckle. Missing that one. Plumed and Rainbow Was Reborn, Plumed Bird. Okay, so it looks like we're missing maybe four tracks here, maybe like 15 minutes of music, 20 minutes of music. So we'll get through this. We'll see how much time we have left, and then we'll come back in at the end. But before we jump in, not only am I excited about this album, but I have not seen the live version. And a couple of you have been telling me that it's got some pretty interesting things in there, especially something about a hair dye job of some kind. Anyway, I'm excited. 1982, Takanaka's 11th studio album, Rainbow Goblins. I'll tell you what, I think we might switch things up today. I think we might switch it up. Did I think this through? Not at all. We're gonna do it though. Okay, I like this string intro. Got the harps.
A long time ago, there was a hidden valley called the Valley of the Rainbow,
where
the animals lived in peace. This valley was the only place in the land which had never known the fear of the seven goblins. Each goblin was named after his own color. Red, orange, indigo.
I don't know, blue boy. He's having a good time. He's leaning back.
Violet. Green. and yellow.
Good intro. Okay. Short little intro there, concise to the point.
Look at this guy. Look at this guy. Okay. Yeah.
Oh, that's what I'm talking about. So there's that Yamaha SG. Super, super customized. Oh, look at this. Look at all that glitter. Oh, yeah. I don't know how much research we're going to get done today, ladies and gentlemen. It might just be, let's watch Rainbow Goblin all day, if y'all are okay with that. Totally right, Ohajiman. I went through and played some Rainbow Goblin a while back, and I was digging on Takanaka, but I just didn't do the deep research into his earlier stuff like we have this week. But man, look at this is so dope. Also, this not only sounds great as a live show, but even beyond that, it looks great, and this fits. So this is what I'm talking about when we're talking about bands that can make something that sounds live like it sounds on the album. Not that it's exactly the same, but that it sounds like the song is just a different variation of it, as opposed to being something really pre-produced where it's totally different live. And Takanaka, man. I mean, look at this. He's got all the different guitars set up for different sounds, I'm sure. You've got the percussion. I can see the two percussion cats in the back, just like we had on the album. Oh, yeah. This is gonna be good. This is gonna be good, everybody. So I guess he's the yellow goblin, because he's got the yellow jumpsuit on. Oh, they're all the goblins! Oh, yeah! Okay, that's cool. That's cool. Yeah, the rainbow colors on his guitar. The guitar is the rainbow. Okay, I'm totally curious on his gear. Okay, we're getting super funky. I want to know where those strings are coming from. Because I know, let's see what this is on the album. No strings. Oh! Katsushi. There we go. He arranged the strings. And then hired somebody. So I wonder if that's a recording. Because the strings sound really good. But I'm going to have to guess this is some kind of pre-recorded strings. But still, sounds great. Oh! And there he is. All right. So now that Zal is in the room, Primus, Rainbow Goblins. I'm jealous. What were they called? The Dissenting Seven? The Despicable Seven? The Desaturating Seven. There we go. Primus version. Oh, look at her hair. Man, everybody got a good hair day these times. All right, we got the Michael Jackson / vampire jacket. Looks good. That guitar is so gnarly. I want to find it. Rainbow Goblins. Hmm.
That's what I'm talking about. Oh, come on, eBay. Oop. Oh. Oh, yeah. This is what I came here for. I'm gonna make it a little bit bigger. Okay. I'd never realized they're literally catching rainbows. He says it in the song, but... Alright. So that was a super dope prologue, but let's talk about this song real quick. Seven Goblins. Super, super funky song. Repeating bass line, repeating guitar line. We've got synthesizers that kick in every once in a while, but this is where the narrator comes in and tells us the whole story, which is, from the best I can tell, Roy Garner. Just some dude. Just some dude who Takanaka got to read the story. But anyway, super cool line, very, very funky. Let's take a listen.
The seven goblins lived by eating the colors from rainbows. For that reason, they were known as the Rainbow Goblins.
Oh, nice, random.
They were always looking
good
for
call.
Rainbows to
zoom
suck the colors from them, and so to fill their bellies. One day, the Rainbow Goblins heard about the Valley of the Rainbow. It gave them an infinite appetite, just thinking about the great banquet they could enjoy there. Immediately, they gathered their tools and set off in search of the legendary valley. It didn't matter to them to roam about the steep hills or to climb up the high mountains. Whenever difficulties arose concerning their journey, they just thought of the delicious colors.
Okay, not to be a jerk, but I wasn't sure how much of this was live and how much of this was pre-recorded until right there. That was the first time I saw him make, I'm not even gonna call it a mistake, just did something different than the album that was like, he's just so clean and plays so well. I'm like, man, really dialed in his tone exactly right. Because this sounds, I mean, not only are the musicians good, but the sound is on point. Like, this sounds like the album. So good. Okay, man, that's, I could listen to that all day. Oh, there it is. Yeah, clap, 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 clap.
The sun was about to set when the goblins finally arrived at the very entrance of
yes.
the valley.
Yes, yes,
the
yes, 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 yes,
gave
yes.
birth to the rainbow. That night, they decided to stay in a cave nearby.
Okay. So, this song, which is super just chill and funky, this is a good time to talk about a couple people here. So, first things first, randomly generated, thank you very much, brought up a very good point. Our keyboardist here, lady actually writing the screenshot, Mimi Izumi Kobayashi. Keyboardist, I'm not very familiar with it all. However, as I look through the credits that she is a part of, it becomes very obvious that I should know much more about her. Because I've heard her before. She's on a lot of Takanaka albums. Bread and Butter, people we still have not done yet. I'm going to stop talking so we can listen to this talk box. Okay, there we go. Back into the shredding. So we talked the other day about two different kinds of talk boxes. One has the tube in your mouth where it shoots the sound in and then it comes back out, which is a much more aggressive kind of talk box. And then we have what he just did there, which is more of what we call a vocoder. They are also, well, actually, I'll take that back. I'll say that backwards. Vocoder,
I don't know. You can have examples of both today that don't have the tube, but that's the two ways of doing it. Okay. So what I ran to go get here for a second, that I'll show you guys real quick. Let's see if my camera is still... Ah, yeah, I'll just do it right here. So this is a 2018 version of what he's doing right there. This is called a vocoder. So this is a pedal that takes my input, whatever that is, guitar or whatever. I can plug a microphone in there, and it blends the two signals together so that it makes my voice sound like the words of the percussion with the sound of my guitar. I have no idea how it works. But this little guy right here, you can change all the knobs. You can get a sound exactly like that. But anyway, shredding. This is a great song. Okay, now going back talking about our keyboardist here. Yeah, she played in a lot of albums with Takanaka. All over the place with him. We see a lot of credits. Pretty consistently has a solid career playing on other people's albums. Plus, she has her own albums. Very cool. Ooh, I like the cover. Tropicana. Those are some good colors. Okay, very cool. Thank you for pulling that thread, randomly generated. That was a good call. Oh man. He's getting it. That's a cool song. Okay, I found it. It's an SG... I think they said it was an SG-1000.
Later
Yamaha,
on,
baby.
Finding the goblins,
they just love their... He loves his Yamahas.
The moon, which had just
there we
risen,
go.
Warned the valley about their arrival.
Boom.
SG-1000. The spread rapidly. The trees, the bushes, the animals, the flowers, the grasses. They all cried with fear. The rainbow goblins have come.
He's just got all the effects, man, like, way early on. I unfortunately got rid of my whammy pedal, but I used to have one of those. You can do so many different things. And that was more of a wah pedal right there, not really a whammy. Rainbow Goblin guitar. Pretty good. No matter what Takanaka does, or really, no matter what any of these artists in Japan are doing, there is no escape of the reggae, or of the African, or of the Latin rhythms. They love them. They just gotta slide one in there. Which is great! I was actually reading on the Discord recently, or I don't know, it wasn't the Citypop Discord, it was Citypop Reddit. Somebody's wanting to do research on reggae and just Latin infiltration into Japanese pop music, and was wanting to know like when that started, and was talking about, we were like asking about artists in the 80s, And here at the channel, I'm sure we're all going, dry 1976. But anyway, it's very interesting because, like we've seen, all these guys are doing, or guys and gals are doing all these things at home, and then they go and travel, go record in another country or have an opportunity, see something, they're like, bring it back, internalize it. About a year later, they turn it into their own thing. Pretty cool. Okay, so let's check in on where we are track-wise now. So 1709. No hope of seeing what track we're on. Let's see if I can look it up. I'm pretty sure this is either Moon. I think this is Soon. Someone help me out. Superman. I can't. I made kind of a dick comment earlier where it's like, is this live? This sounds too good. Nobody can be this good. Takanaka, man. Clean. Really, really clean player. Because, you know, it's one thing to shred. It's another thing to so cleanly articulate and the pedals and compressors and things to help him out. But, and it's musical too. Like this. Also, that sound, that wah, 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 that's called slow gear. It takes your sound, and instead of it hitting right when you do it, it expands afterwards. Gear tip of the day. Oh, that was a tasty lick. Yeah. Randomly generated. Good info. Let's check it out. I know, I saw it exist. It was right here. Why is that not on Discogs? Did I find something I'm gonna put on Discogs today? Perhaps so. Oh, that was cool.
But some roots,
good job,
hanging
Takanaka.
Loosely from
that
the ceiling of the cave, listened carefully all while right. The goblins schemed below.
Good find, randomly generated. I dig it. Okay, let's take a second now. Let's appreciate a little bit of what we're hearing right now. It's slamming down on some bass, man. We got so good. Okay, it is just to knock out the entire album. All right, we'll turn down just a little bit here. So good. Sorry, y'all. Today is more of just kind of like a hangout, watch movie session, less than a learn anything about Takanaka. But we've learned a lot this week about him. But anyway, we're taking a second here just to look at his bass player for this album. Akihiro Tanaka. I'm only going to say it four more times, stumbling. Very cool bass player. Very chill. Not one that pops out with a whole lot of flashy lines or busyness, but super funky and very appropriate. Look at this. Okay, right here. Perfect example. Just following the bass hits. But then a little taste. Pom pom. This is how you use space in a song. And then just bam! No, this is Rainbow Goblins. Slap across the face. That was tasty. That was some tasty Takanaka right there. Ooh. Oh, it's hard not to get sucked into this. Okay. Oh, yeah. Okay, anyway, going back to our bass player here. Akihiro. Great bass player. And we've heard him already before when we were doing Taiko Onuki. He did that album. Tatsuro Yamashita, he's played with him. Not on Right on Time. He played with Mungo, the album right before Right on Time. And he played with him afterwards too. More Takanaka. I believe there's more. Oh, look at that. Toshiki Kanematsu, Sea Breeze. That's a big album. And that actually kind of ruins my point of saying he's a subdued bass player, because Sea Breeze is a pretty funky album, so. But yeah, Taiko Nuki again. There we go. I was thinking that he had. Oh, there's some more Tatsuro. Very. Did that say Clinton? Oh, Chinatown. Harry Hanzo? Interesting. But, well put together band. Very good flow. They're tight. Good group. But again, Takanaka chose a different crew. Not really the same cast of characters that we've seen before. We've got, I think, is Izumi? Is she from an earlier album that we looked at? I think she might be. No, she's not from the previous album. Is she from... I know she's not on Insatiable High, because that's Patrice Rushen. Is she on Seashells? Nope, she's new. Yeah. No, it's a great performance, Poppy. I totally agree. Super, super good. And even though we're pretty much only seeing Takanaka in the center just shredding on guitar, I love how they're all dressed up in different goblin outfits, wearing black coats. Like, it's just fun. It's a good show. And this was still in the era too. You can tell they've got those disco cameras. You know, the ones where it's like every single shot is oversaturated, everything is shiny, everything is reflective. Like, even if this wasn't a live show about rainbow goblins, it would look like rainbows. In the
distance. Great. A wild storm, they said.
Uh-oh.
Knowing storm. That the most wonderful rainbows spring from the biggest thunderstorms, they began to dance.
Okay, so this is probably side... Oh, thunderstorm. So we just finished the live version of side one. Now we're on side... Actually, we're on disc two now, technically. Because it's four sides. Mega Man, eat your heart out.
Ah, yes!
Oh, you're kidding me!
Yes! 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 Yes!
Oh, we're done, y'all. Okay, I'm not wasting my time on the internet anymore. I won. We're just gonna relax and enjoy this together.
Oh, hell yeah, look at that hat. Oh.
This,
This is good prog rock. Cause I like me some prog rock, but this was worth the wait for lightning. And just, man, RG exactly got it. Boss music. This is all of this stuff is proto video game music, man. This is where they got the ideas from. This is 1981. Mega Man comes out, 1985, 1986? This is what this is. It's MIDI digitized version of the opening of this song. And like these little repetitive hooks, it's perfect for video game music because they need something that loops so it doesn't take up a ton of space, because memory was a huge problem early on in video game development. So it's cool to see these connections. And those hats! Those hats! Oh! Oh, she's wearing the hat too! Oh yeah. That is hard. Get some! Ow! Oh man. That is so awesome. Man, everybody in this band is clean. Wow, this is crazy. This is so good. Okay, playing your instrument that clean is hard. Playing it on stage with lights and smoke and on and off constantly happening is more difficult. Playing it with what I can only imagine is a 28-pound hat shaped like a goblin. These people are machines. This is awesome. And she's getting into it. Oh yeah. Maybe it's like paper mache. Only weighs like 2 pounds. Oh, this is so good. Minor mode, here come the goblins. Whoa, Kenny G! Where'd you come from? What if it was Kenny G? Oh, wouldn't that be good? That's a pretty funky... Is that alto sax? No, what do they call those? I should know this. Oh yeah. We got that driving disco drum. Oh, there it is. Mega Man. Oh, that is Mega Man right there. Absolutely. And Castlevania. Pretty much Konami soundtrack from 1985 to 1989. Oh, look at that. Oh, that goblin mask, man. Oh, yeah. You see, it's this kind of stuff that makes me want to pull my guitar back out. But I know that I would just be sad. That's what frustrated me away from the guitar originally, was trying to be clean. Because, I mean, it's nice to have the good equipment. But you gotta have that technique, baby. Oh, what's up, Desi? Welcome to the party. Man, you did join at the right time. It is going ham. Oh, yeah. That's never gonna get old. Funky. That is a noose. That is dangerous. This is cool artwork. Oh, look. It's like the cover. Very cool. All right. Rambo Goblins, man. Whew. I'm glad we finally get a slow track so we can
catch our breath a little bit from what just happened, which was nothing short of amazing. So we have come a huge distance in 5 years. This is 1981. Last thing we saw, 4 years. 1977, Takanaka. So we have gone from first three solo albums being all very different from each other and unique in very cool ways and, you know, positive uniqueness. But they're all still kind of in the same realm of funk rock and, you know, chill vibe. I don't know. You get the same kind of feel for at least two or three of the tracks out of each album. They all have that. We had that, not a reggae, but we had like a Latin beat, samba, or Latin song of some kind, African beats. Then we would have one slow dance kind of song. And then we would have one super funk song that really just cuts loose and opens up. Now, later here, I know we've skipped over quite a few albums. Let's see. Two albums in 1978, one in 79. Three albums in 1980. Now keep in mind, one of them is a live album, but still, T-Wave, that's another album that's a very different Takanaka album. And then again, 1981, two different albums, Alone, which I don't know very well, and Rainbow Goblins, what we're listening to now. This is different, way different. There are certain things that you can still pick out together, like, let's see if we have our same engineer, our same overarching sound guy or gal. Let's look, because I'm trying to remember who this cat's name was, this Tokyo dude. Let's find him. Engineer. Oh! I didn't know that. Is this the same guy? What? No. Okay, that's a different guy. Anyway, but we're talking about different sounds and how these albums move through, and all these guys are doing two albums in a year. You know, we saw that first with Maria Takeuchi, and she was not the first, but she was doing that. Taiko Nuki was doing that at a certain point in time. Tatsuro does that for like 10 years straight. And now Takanaka, he's another one that's doing this. But this is just different. Different group of people. Different artists, different feel. But it still has that Takanaka sound. And yeah, it's because he's the guitarist. It's the same way it's like Santana has Santana sound, which, by the way, he did play with. And also, which one of you was hooking us up on the stream, talking to us about, is it George Santana or Jorge Santana, the brother? Like, great nugget of info. I had no idea. But yeah, very cool how this is all tied together. All right, let's listen to some Takanaka. Okay. So that little knob that says advanced, that's what this is. It's turning much more robotic with his voice, and he's playing a chord. And instead of the chord guitar sound, it's his voice. And he made that with his mouth, just going. Sorry, blowing on the mic.
Saved by the flowers, the rainbow was reborn, more glorious and more splendid.
Okay, last track of side three.
As an act of grace, the rainbow transformed the flowers into beautiful butterflies, brilliant dragonflies, and magnificently plumed birds.
Man, I really want to listen to the Primus version out here. It's different. I think my brain is going to melt before this album is done. Oh, and look at the light show with all the colors. Oh, he's having fun. There was our boy. Akihiro Tanaka. Oh yeah. Are we full volume? Yeah. Okay, so coming back in here for a second, as we're getting close to the end here of this album, we'll just listening to the shred fest that is Masayoshi Takanaka. These guys, so good. And every one of them is some kind of tied-in studio musician, it looks like. I mean, with the exception of maybe one or two backup singers or maybe one or two producers or something like that, all these people on these albums go back and have solo albums. They have releases on other people's albums. Okay, here's an example of somebody who has stuck with Takanaka. Kisosumi Ishikawa. Almost exclusively Takanaka. We've got four albums that are not with Takanaka. So that's an example of somebody who stuck right with him. However, we look at our bass player. All over the place. 57 different records, or credits of playing on or writing on. Same thing here. We talked about the first two albums, Seashells. Totally different group. People from the Mika band. We look at Insatiable High. It's all American jazz musicians. The George Benson Connection. I'm going to copyright that one. And as we go through here, the same thing happens. Look at T-Wave. We've got some of the same people. Why do you always make me got to click on that one? See, we got some of the same people, but we still got new blood in there. So, Takanaka, very interesting character, knows what he wants, knows the sound he's going for. He will pick out those people and bring them into the fold. It's cool. Rainbow's symbol of a generation of promise. Very positive. I like that. I like that image. Oh, listen to that bass getting funky on us now. Finally allowed to open up a little bit. That's a good bass sound. Oh, I like that. Where's my boy? There he is. Oh, yeah. Eat your heart out, yes. King Crimson. Okay, well, maybe not King Crimson. But. Whoa. You don't just show that one time and then never again. Yeah, that's right. Give it to me again. Yes! Give it to me in close-up. Huh. I always thought that was a flute. I didn't know that was a sax. Huh. That slapstick, dude. Now, in this, like, it sounds good here, but let me tell you, as a guy who's played in orchestras for many years, on the rare occasions that a piece I'm playing in calls for a slapstick, that son of a gun is so loud. It literally sounds like a gunshot. It's great in an arena, terrible 5 feet away from you. Yeah. Yeah, that's exactly, yeah, Panda got this one covered. That's it, man. It's two boards. If you're fancy, sometimes they put a hinge on it to make it easier to slap, but that's it. Crack. Dude, can we also just take a second to talk about Takanaka's sweet-as-hell mustache? This, like, 1950s Little Richard, like, drawn-on, perfect little pencil mustache. I've got to say that's an homage to Little Richard. Look at that thing. Look at it. Look at that perfect thing. And then he's got that sweet glitter hair. Takanaka, you can look at his face, he's just like... Oh, yeah, okay, so I'm gonna shred here. Okay, then let's see what now. Oh, yeah, melt the mind. There it is. Okay, yep, just like that. Okay, finally, we're sounding a little bit like Seashells.
Now I hear some seashells Takanaka. A little bit of insatiable high in there, maybe. See, Takanaka always keeps it, always brings it back home. Oh, yeah. I love her hair. She's got the Patrice Russian hair. If you, this was super in at the time. And Patrice Russian made this very, very popular. This whole thing. And she was playing on the album 4 years before this. So maybe they met each other. She's like, oh yeah, I like your hair. Ooh, that bass. Oh yeah. There's, oh yeah, we got that guitar face. You can always tell when a guitarist is getting into something, because they'll give you one of these. Oh, yeah. You definitely got one. Now he's opening up. Ooh. Oh, man. Oh, man. This is tight. Oh! Yeah! Oh, man. Okay. That is unbelievably tight. So there's a band called ELP, Emerson, Lake, and Palmer. I took a music history course one time with a genius professor. And on top of his extensive knowledge of 19th and 20th century music history in America and in Europe, he's a huge prog rock fan. And he knows all of ELP stuff. And he would tell me one of the reasons why he thought ELP was one of the greatest prog rock bands of all time is how tight they were and how well they can stay together. Because a lot of times they'll use other bands, not all of them, and this is not the great ones, but you can use reverb, distortion, all these other things to kind of hide if it's exactly together or not, or you can warp your tone to distort it to make it easier to tie in together. But man, these guys here, this is like LP levels of tightness. Super crisp, super clean, everything put together. And Takanaka is a beast. Beast. He's been shredding now for 40 minutes, pretty much nonstop. And in my ears, I clocked one time, he forgot to turn his volume knob up all the way. And so like two notes were a little too quiet. Everything else is great. Not that it matters that you play all the right notes. That doesn't mean anything. It's all about the emotion and the feel. You got to get most of the notes. But this is just such a cool performance on top of it being a cool album. I know today I was a little less doing research here going into what's happening with the time period and the people and all this, but I think this was a good little diversion for us to hang out and watch a live concert together. And let me know if you guys like this, because if this is something that you want to do more often, I'm happy to do this as well. I think it's fun. I enjoy seeing new shows like this and all this kind of good stuff. But yeah, let me know. So we're coming to an end here. I think we are right now at You Can Never Come to This Place. I'm pretty sure. Somebody can hook me up with the info if I'm wrong. Because I know you guys know better than me. Yeah. Okay. Looks like I'm getting some positive feedback on this one. Well, good. Yeah, Santana trying to tame the snake guitar. One thing I also saw on the citypop Reddit, people in the citypop Discord, they're the archaeologists digging through all the hard drives and Japanese sites, pulling stuff out. But they're starting to put up more live shows on YouTube. And somebody was also saying that Spotify has more stuff. I don't know what the licensing is if I try to play Spotify music through here. I'll look into it, but anyway. Yeah, I'm totally down to do live albums because it's fun to see exactly what's in the album
what sound like a interesting live interpretation of the album and who go totally off the rails into something different. So this, I think, was a really, really good interpretation of the album because it sound the quality sounded really, really good. We had all the same instrumentation, all the same musicians. We didn't have a ton of extra people or anything like that. And now we got this epic-ass ending. Oh, yeah, take that, Kiss. This is very God Give Rock and Roll to Us by Kiss. I think it's like 1983 or 84. Maybe it's earlier. Oh, yeah, what else? What other rock band does this sound like? Just like epic outro. Queen. I don't know. Epic ballad outro. It was just cool. Oh, yeah. Chance. It's all good, Chance. You can watch. We got an archive. Oh, man. It's just so cool because, like, there are just certain things that he's doing right now that this is such a silly connection. But My Chemical Romance, I was super into them when I was a teenager. And this right here, this kind of solo, even though this is a Queen solo, like, that verse, I mean, it sounds just like a Queen solo from Bohemian Rhapsody. Yeah, blah, 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 blah. But My Chemical Romance, that guitarist dude, whoever he is, like, there's a solo in one of their songs that sounds exactly like this, just sped up. But, you know, it's not worth going into who did it first and who was the actual first person, blah, 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 blah. It just matters who were the people doing it at the time, who was doing it uniquely, who was doing their own thing. Because those are the successful people. The successful musicians, if you look back, the really, really tight ones are the ones who just said, whatever, man, I'm going to do my own thing. Follow me. Man. So such an interesting character. Masayoshi Takanaka. Okay. So we're going to go ahead and just let this outro here play for a second while we're done for the day. Man, I got a little bit... Black Parade. I'm a little older than that. Yeah, it was actually 3 cheers for Sweet Revenge, and even before that, the Vampires Will Never Hurt You. Anyway, we're not talking about my emo life right now. Okay, Masayoshi Takanaka. What a beast. What a beast. Okay, we're going to switch back over here. Okay, I still got a little bit of battery left on the camera. All right, well, thank you for hanging out today, guys. This was fun. This is a cool album. This was a good time. And from the sounds from the chat, it looks like we might be doing some more live streams. Or live concert streams, maybe on Fridays, maybe every other week when we get something. I don't know. We'll see. Anyway, I'll be thinking hard about what to be talking about next week. I've already got some topics from you guys, but another thing that I want to do is set up an official Discord location where we can have set up for what tabs you guys want me to work on next, what songs you'd like to hear, what topics you'd like on Wake and Bass, what times we can do these night jams and have a night show, all that kind of stuff. Organize it in a better place because the City Pop Discord place is phenomenal, but there's so much stuff there and I don't really want to invade in their territory. Plus, there are other great people like Masa Bluesman. His channel's awesome if you haven't checked out his channel. He's got his own Discord now. City Pop Dave, he does bass tabs. Might talk him into getting a channel sometime too, doing something with that. But anyway, thank you guys so much for hanging out. If you had a good time, a like and subscribe. Always makes me happy. Hope you guys have a fantastic weekend, and I will catch you all on Tuesday. All right, Rainbow Goblin. So good. So good. Have a good one, guys.